We're still getting some feedback here. We were testing this before. We had a lot of interesting challenges. How are we doing here? Not yet. I'm looking to cut it completely and go with it. Can you hear me without anything at all?
Yeah.
We're just going to cut the straps.
So we'll try it this way and see how we do. What do you think? How about show up? I'm so glad you're here. I guess it would be appropriate since the Passover is a special Sabbath worship. It would be normal for Hebrew people, Jewish people, as they gather for the Passover Seder, to begin with the expression Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Sabbath, Passover special Sabbath. Shalom is the traditional Hebrew greeting. It means peace, literally, or hello, if you're greeting someone, or if you're bidding farewell, shalom can be also goodbye, either way. So if we say Shabbat Shalom together, it would be an appropriate greeting for you inside the place. Let's try it out. It's Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Let's put my hands on. So glad that you're here. Exciting night. This is one that we look forward to. Pete and Glenn, you are here with us. This is our 10th year doing our Christ in the Passover Seder events. And how many of you have been to one of our events at least once before? Okay. How many of you are here for the very first time? Here for the first time. Look at that. That's wonderful. Now, what of you here for the first time, how many of you have never been to a Passover Seder before? Most of those who just raised their hand. So I'm encouraged and blessed by that. That's wonderful. That's exciting for us. We're glad for the mix. Probably about half or so that are here and have been here before, and another half have been for the first time. My name is Pastor Gary Finn. I'm pastor of William Baptist Church with me, just about a mile from here at St. Joe's Academy on Sunday mornings. And this is our 10th year, as we mentioned, conducting this. I come from Jewish background. So my whole life was centered around the excitement of the observance of Passover. My grandfather was the spiritual patriarch of our family, and every year, I can remember as a young child, he led us in our Passover observance every spring, and those memories are just deeply settled in my heart and my soul. Such fond memories. They become an important foundation for any Jewish family, the observance of the traditional Passover. And it was some 40 plus years ago, as a college student, when I came to a place of embracing and discovering that Yeshua, his Hebrew name Jesus, was my Savior and Messiah and Lord, that my understanding of the Passover took on an entirely new meaning. And I can remember the very first year after embracing Jesus as my Savior, in the spring of 1972, I was 22 years old, 21 years old. Guys, do the math. Oh, okay. Here with me. I have to do it every day. As a 21-year-old college student, sitting at the Passover table with my family, going through the traditions of the Passover that were part of my upbringing, it was difficult for me to go through that Seder that night because I had never anticipated, even though I had known Jesus for about 6 months, wasn't really prepared for what it would be practicing and going through the traditional observance. Because with great clarity, what I saw was the presence of Jesus all the way through the Passover Seder. The traditions of our people, the Jewish people, it's not a secret to be able to say we have the historical record of the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, to know that we haven't exactly been the best when it comes to obeying God and following Him. The record of the Old Testament prophets and the historical books is a record that confirms that our people, over and over again, repeatedly turned away from the commandments of God, from the instructions of God, always under God's rebuke and discipline, constant message in all of the prophets over and over again. And while that's true, what is remarkable is that one area that our people remained faithful to consistently over the centuries was the observance of the traditional Passover as God had instructed. And as the rabbis developed over the course of even centuries together. And I say that to say that the traditional Passover Seder that is observed all over the world in many different cultures is largely the same as it's been for several thousand years and more, 3,000 years. The same elements that we will work through and go through together have been followed in a wide variety of cultures, even though the Jews have been dispersed not only throughout the Middle East, but throughout Europe and throughout South Africa and even Latin America, and certainly here in the States. While there may be some slight variations of culture, the traditional Passover is largely the same. It has been for the South and East. To understand that, and then to work through what we will be working through tonight, I think would be that much more meaningful for you, especially understanding how Jesus fulfilled so much of what is there. There are five great festivals of worship during the calendar year. The Hebrew people go through Passover is the first in the calendar year, and the first of the month of Nisan, and it is the one most familiar to practice today, but one that, along with all of the five feasts, so clearly have their fulfillment in Jesus. Now, on your table, you have several items. You have a little glossary of Hebrew terms, and we'll be using a lot of Hebrew words tonight. They're all here with their meeting. We'll teach a little Hebrew 101. We'll go home and just get scholars by the time we're done. There's also some children's material. I guess a number of young families, which we're always excited, because Passover is a time for family gatherings. Imagine we were in a large dining area, gathered as a family together around the table. That's where the traditional families would be. The children were part of it. And so some of the literature there, the coloring material is there for the children as well. The way we do this, about 45 minutes we spend going through the longest portion of our Passover observance before feast, and then about 20 minutes afterwards. The portion afterwards is very powerful. It is in the elements of that closing section that what many of you perhaps practice from different backgrounds of Christianity, different denominations. Some of your traditions may call it Eucharist or Communion or the Lord's Supper, you know what I'm referring to. All of that is so absolutely completed in Jesus. He referenced all of it. And we'll be pointing that out this evening. You will find great significance as we bring the evening to a conclusion. So, as we begin together, I'll also denote that my garb, what I'm wearing, is fairly traditional at the most Passover observances. The white robe is called a kittel. That's a relatively easy word to pronounce in Hebrew. It's got pretty much English phonetic sound to it. Maybe you can say that word with me. It's the word kittel. Try it. The white robe is the robe of a priest. And we know under the Old Covenant, the tradition is that the priests represented the people of Israel before God. And in the Hebrew family, the patriarch of the home, my grandfather when he was alive, my eldest uncle who died after my grandfather's passing, filling that role, they would wear the kittel, the white robe of the priest, because in terms of accountability, the patriarch of the home was responsible for the spiritual welfare of his family, representing his family before God. Back during the days when the temple stood and the tabernacle stood, and sacrifices were to be offered, it would be the family patriarch who would bring the lamb, the sacrificial lamb, to the priest for sacrifice on behalf of his family. And so there's the priestly role, the kid. Then also there is, I'm wearing a more traditional head covering, you know, this is called a yarmulke, typically worn on the Sabbath or any time of worship. During Passover, the more traditional head garb, which I don't have, is called a mitar, another one that's relatively easy to pronounce. Mitar, let me try that one.
Mitar.
The robe is called a kiddo, and the head covering would be a, and it looks almost like a baker's cap, kind of fluffy, a bit elevated in the scalp, and it was intended to be communicative of the crown of the king. Because the patriarch of Kohala was on the one level a priest to his family, representing his family before the priest and God, and also responsible for the protection, the provision of his family. And he was responsible for headship, rule over his family, and thus he would wear the crown of the king, assuming that very sacred role of headship and protection and provision and accountability. So the patriarch of the home would be both king and priest. It's not by accident that Yeshua, Jesus, also is our king, our Mashiach, our Messiah, and he is our priest, the one mediator between God and man, who offered that sacrifice for sin. So the garb is particular. This is called the talis, or talit. It is a wrapping, a garland, a wrap, but also symbolizing humbling ourselves before God. We are wrapped in the truth of God. Symbols of the commandments are on the top. And we wrap ourselves in the Word of God that our need to express into the Lord. We want to be surrounded by, enveloped in the truth of your Word, directing our steps. And so the talis would be traditionally as well. The Passover celebration would begin several days beforehand. Passover this year is very late. It actually starts, I believe, the 22nd of April. A few weeks away from now, much removed from Easter time. Usually, of course, the Hebrew calendar and the Roman calendar don't coincide. So the timings of those events don't always blend together. But several days before the Passover, there would be a process in which everything in the household, all baking goods that had any kind of leaven, would be removed, would be packed up. I remember my family, my grandparents and my aunts and uncles and my mama packing everything up in boxes, anything in the household that had left. Unprepared foods, just boxes of it. And it was a time of year where, quite frankly, we lived in a community where there was a lot of Jewish people as well as non-Jewish people. All of the neighbors came to know that it was a great time of year for free food. Because we would give it all away. And all of our neighbors, Gentile neighbors, got boxes full of food to be able to bring home. They just didn't have to budget the food shop away. They're taking a couple of weeks. Everything is removed, not only all the food items, but in addition to that, anything that would be used to place the food upon, for example, the dishes and silverware that were typically used during the course of the year, all of that would be packed up and removed as well. Cookware, pots, pans, dishes, silverware, all of it's gone. And out would come special dishes and silverware, pots and pans and cooking utensils. Everything that was packed away would be only for the 8 days of Passover would be brought out exclusively for that week. So that there'd be no defilement, no sign of leaven whatsoever. Because leaven was a symbol of impurity. So all the utensils are gone, pots and pans are gone, food items are gone, dishes are gone, Passover utensils, and all the rest are brought out for that week. All of that is occurring as we prepare for the beginning of the Passover. In addition to all the cleaning out of the leaven, the night before Passover begins, my grandmother, patriarch of the home, they traveled through the corners of the home with a dustpan and dustpan, and symbolically go around the home just picking up any last morsels of dust, just in case there be even a crumb of love in any area of the house. The way of communicating that we want to be absolutely pure and undefiled before you, O God, for we worship you at this festive time at Passover. And the crumbs that will be picked up and removed, the Hebrew word is the word different from the words. All the kids love this word because it's a hard guttural CN sound. You can really go to that. It's the word chometz. You've got to get that. That almost spit-like set working here. It's not chumitz. And it's not kumitz. It's chumitz. Well, Fred, just don't, you know, don't get too carried away. If somebody you know might use near you, maybe you can aim that way. Try the word chumitz with me. Chumitz. How many of you ever said that word? Anybody ever smack you in the face of your brother? Chometz! Leaven! Remember that first Passover, God's instruction for the Israelites, they were to not use any leaven, but the bread would be baked unleavened bread in the heat of the Egyptian sun out of the desert, and unleavened, no time for the bread to rise quick. Put food that night, but afterwards, of course, leaven, again, a symbol of impurity and our desires to be unleavened before God. By the way, for those of you who are biblical scholars, keep in mind that terminology. When you think of these words of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 and 7 and 8, listen to it, because this is all Passover language. Paul said, don't you know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? A little chometz makes everything else impure. Passover terminology. Just like you're getting rid of all the crumbs, all the chometz, all the impurity. It's a symbolism picture. A little bit of sin causes all the guilt and the danger. Clean out the old leaven. Let's describe that, getting rid of all the stuff in the household. Clean out the old leaven, that you might be a new lump, just as you were, in fact, unleavened, for Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. All Passover language and imagery in the instruction of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians and chapter 5. And so all of that will be done for the night before Passover. Yes. By the way, the word Passover in Hebrew is the word Pesach. You know those are good singing sounds. Let's try it. Pesach. Passover. There you go. The word Seder, I guess in English it's spelled typically S-E-D-E-R. The Hebrew word Seder means the service or the order of service. So when we use the term Passover Seder, we're talking about the worship order and sequence as we celebrate the Passover. That's the term Passover Seder. Typically, what is used for that is something called a Haggadah. I'm going to try that one, that's a pretty easy word. And Haggadah. And we celebrate tonight a Pesach Seder. Good. We're getting there. And we use a Haggadah, which is basically a guide through the first 12 chapters of the book of Exodus, reminding us of Israel's bondage in Egypt, what God did to ultimately liberate them from bondage, sending Moses back to confront Pharaoh, the plagues upon the Egyptians, Israel being set free through the Red Sea. All of that is retold every Passover season. God's instruction was to be certain that this message be passed down from generation to generation. So we do that together tonight. You'll notice the center of your table, or I guess at the end of your table, there is an interesting plate with some unusual items on it. This Passover plate has some things we'll be sharing it together. Passover is a multi-sensory experience of sight and smell and, yes, taste. all of it with imagery and symbolism. The Passover is filled with symbols. We're experiencing that happening tonight. Keep that in mind, especially for the evening. We'll make reference to those items as well. If we were gathered in our home at the far end of the table, closest to the door, there would be one empty seat. An empty seat, whole place setting, with the cup that is there. We'll explain more about that at the end. It is a very significant symbol as well. You also have on your table a plate of matzah, and you'll be referencing the importance of the matzah as well. Jesus, in Luke chapter 22 and verse 15, as he gathered with his disciples, this would be his fourth and final Passover celebration of the year. And Jesus said, quoting in Luke 22, 15, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover. Of all of the years, the three previous years, now four, of celebrating, he understood this would take on much greater meaning. He knew its significance. He knew its meaning. He knew his own role in fulfilling all of the symbols of the Passover. He was eager because he understood, as he would teach them, what they needed to learn about his being the Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world. Passover Seder begins with the lighting of the candles. And what I'd like for you to do, there is in the center of each table a small matchbox. And we're going to ask, each table has the privilege and responsibility of choosing, appointing, electing, threatening, whatever it takes. One of the ladies to fill this role as our candle bearer. Now, you don't have to do this, but we do it symbolically because this is what typically would be done. A head covering, a sign of our humility before the Lord. And before we light the candles, I'm going to recite the Hebrew prayer. Have you all manipulated, cajoled, elected, chosen someone, a lady to fill that role, whatever it takes, I'll twist it. Here's the Hebrew prayer. We'll explain it after we light the candles. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has set us apart by his word, and in whose name we light the testimony of lights. Ladies, if you would, please. Ladies, somebody make me a table of light for the candle, if you would. Thank you. The lighting of the candles is not only a tradition at the beginning of every Sabbath, it's also central in Passover worship. You remember in the tabernacle and temple, in the larger of the rooms, the holy place, there was a candelabra that the priests would light at the beginning of every day of worship. And then light the candelabra and reminded them that God was the source of our light. God was the source of our life. God was the source of truth and purity and direction. And every day as the candles would be lit in the holy place, it would be the priest's expression. Oh God, may you be the source of our light. May you guide us into truth. May you guide us to let me see you above all else. For there's no one else we'd rather see but you. And so the symbolism of lighting the candles is an invitation for God's light, God's truth, God's presence to be clear as we worship at the Passover. Jesus, during his ministry in the 8th chapter of the Gospel of John, teaching his disciples, used that imagery of himself. Do you remember that? Jesus said, I am the light of the world. I am the source of guidance, direction, truth, purity, holiness, righteousness. I am only that source. And so we recognize Jesus as well. Now, there's a couple of great tools that we can. Many Passover celebrations, there may be a large cup, a goblet of wine. Sometimes there'll be four cups of wine that will be there. Because during the Passover Seder, one of the things that we do is partake on four different occasions, drinking from the cup. And this comes from the book of Exodus in the 6th chapter, verses 6 and 7, when God is calling Moses. God has given to Moses instruction, commands, responsibilities for his role in leading the people of Israel to freedom from bondage. And there are four I will statements in those verses in Exodus chapter 6, verses 6 and 7. I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. That represents the couple sharing a moment called the cup of sanctification. I will separate you. I will bring you out. I will separate you from bondage. That's the first cup. The second statement, I will free you from being slaves. The second I will statement, God's promise to the Israelites that their freedom would come through the path of judgment upon Egypt, and plagues upon the Egyptians are remembered as we will share in that cup before we eat. So there's the second statement, the cup of judgment and the cup of plagues. The third, God's promise in verse 7, I will redeem you with an outstretched arm. I will buy you, purchase you, deliver you from bondage to freedom. And that cup, the cup of redemption, we will share in after we eat. And then the fourth I will statement, I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. That is the cup of praise, the Hallel cup, the cup reminding them of the covenants of God, the promises of God given to the Israelites at the very end. So we begin with the first cup. So if you would please, pick up your cup of juice. I will recite the Hebrew prayer, I'll translate it, and take a sip. And then I'll explain it to you briefly. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, horei harim hagafen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. Take a sip of this drink. Now Jesus recited that prayer. We know that from Luke's words in Luke chapter 22, verse 17. Luke tells us when Jesus had taken the cup and given thanks. That's the magic word. As soon as Luke tells me Jesus had taken the cup and given thanks, what I know is the prayer I just prayed. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine, who brings life out of the fruit. Keep that prayer in mind, because Luke tells us in Luke 22, verse 17, when Jesus had taken the cup and given thanks, he said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Which was Jesus' way of saying, guys, tonight's our last Passover Seder. We will not celebrate the Passover again, partaking the fruit of the vine, entering into this great covenant together, no longer here, until the kingdom of God comes. Which I always found rather interesting. It suggests to me, and I always put this disclaimer, it's my own personal suspicion. I can't be dogmatic, I can't be authoritative, I can't be absolute. I have a suspicion that by those very words of Jesus, the inference may well be that in the future, in the book of Revelation, the Bible talks about the time after Jesus comes when we gather with him in heaven at what is called the marriage supper of the Lamb. It's my own thought that it's likely to be Passover celebration. By Jesus' words, we'll not celebrate again until the kingdom of God comes. I think it's going to be a whole new kind of Passover Seder with even greater meaning, greater fulfillment than ever before. So whatever we enjoy in tonight, as rich as I trust it will be, it'll be just a more solid paradise ahead. If we know Jesus as our Savior and Messiah. So there's the first call. Now this next portion we really can't do, it's just not practical to do, but I will hear. If we were at our dinner table together, there would be a large basin of pure water, and I would begin the process of taking my hands and washing them, just taking my hands, kind of washing them, and then with a white towel, and just drying my hands, and then I would move past the basin of water around to all of us at the dinner table to go through the same process together. And that is called a ceremony. The Hebrew word is again, glossary, orchats. I'll try that one. It is orchats. It's the ceremony of hand washing. David the psalmist in Psalm 24 said, "Who may ascend to the hill of the Lord?" Referencing the temple. "Who may stand in his holy place? But he who has clean hands and a pure heart," symbolism, from the ministry of the priest. Because always when the priest would offer sacrifices for sin beforehand, in addition to dressing, he would go through ceremonial washings at the bronze laver just outside the tabernacle or temple. And a symbolism of being pure, washing, cleaning myself. Lord, I want to be pure before you. I want to be holy before you. A priestly desire, as he represents the people before God. And so we would go through this hand-washing ceremony around the table. Jesus did that for 3 years, but in the last year, something changed. Something big changed. So much so that Peter thought Jesus was developing a memory loss. John is the only one that tells us in John 13 what Jesus did that was different. Who remembers what he did that was different? What he did that was different? What he did? Washing. Remember, they were reclining. We'll talk about it in a minute. They weren't sitting in chairs. They were reclining. The reference of the head. And what Jesus did was stand up and go to the entrance to the room and put on the robe of the servant. And then he took a different basin. The basin that was used by the servant to welcome guests into the home for washing the feet. Jesus put on the servant's apron and took the servant's basin and moved around the outskirts of the room, washing the feet of the disciples one by one. Peter saying, "Whoa, tea, time out, huddle up, this isn't the script." Right? Jesus said it. "If I don't wash your feet, you're completely dirty." And then Peter said, "In that case, give me a bath." Jesus then followed it up with teaching. Jesus said to his disciples, "Listen, a servant's not greater than his master. You call me rabbi and teacher, you're right. If I'm your Lord and your rabbi, and I do this, follow my steps." He wasn't instructing the literalness of washing feet in a Passover filled with symbolism. Jesus said in Mark 10, verse 45, "The Son of Man came not to be served," not the first time, not as a king. I didn't come, Jesus said, "to be served, but to serve." And then he identified what he did. He came to serve by giving his life a ransom for men. And when Jesus traveled around the outskirts of the room and washed the feet of his disciples, he was already beginning to communicate once again, not only in literal language, but in symbolism. "I am preparing to be your servant. I am preparing to give my life as a payment for your sin." So there's the ceremony of the orchats. Now, it's time for some appetizers. because the Seder plate is important, filled with things will be tasty together. And one of the things you'll see on your Seder plate is some green parsley. So what I want you to do, and I don't know how you're going to want to do this, but each person's going to want to grab a sprig of parsley. It's not something big, something that's already broken for you. There's also a cup of, looks like water, with water with some salt in it. I shouldn't do it all. But everybody wants to grab a piece of parsley, if you would. And then the last person to grab a piece of parsley will also then take off of the plate the cup of water with it. I'll explain to you once you've all done that what we're about to do. Parsley, green vegetation. In Hebrew, it's called karpos. Another easy word to pronounce. Want to try it? It's the word karpos. Karpos, speaking of the green of springtime, symbols of life. And what we will be doing after I recite the Hebrew prayer, everybody on the sprig of parsley, we're dead in here. One person has a cup of water. In a few moments, what we're going to do after we pray is when the cup gets to you, we're going to take the sprig of parsley, kind of stir it around in that water a little bit, and we'll be eating the parsley in a moment. It's not one of the delicacies of the Passover. Trust me, the food will be much better, but it communicates it more. Let me recite the Hebrew prayer. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the earth, who creates life out of the earth. So with that in mind, where we've got the cup, start it off, dip it, swirl it real good, and then pass the cup around. Really well. Tastes like the Atlantic Ocean. Very salty, it's hard to communicate that. Is it salty? I did a Seder a couple of weeks ago on the New York State. And I don't know who did the mix with the salt water, but they must have hated us. It didn't taste like the Atlantic Ocean, it tastes like the Dead Sea. My goodness, it communicated the truth. Parsley, green, life. Salt water. Have you ever been in a place of emotion in your life where you've been so broken and weeping? Tears rolling down from your eyes, down your cheeks, making their way down to your lips and then kind of coming into your lips. I don't really know where I'm going, right? What's the flavor? Salted. The metaphor, the picture, the illustration, our people suffered incredible anguish and bondage in Egypt. Hardship beyond description and slavery. They got worse and worse and worse, and they wept in their suffering and pain. The tears, the salt water to remind us of their tears. But God in His faithfulness and His promise and covenant, God delivered them out of bondage, delivered them from that hardship, set them free, gave them new life, our slave new life, out of suffering coming. And so our partaking of the parsley and salt water communicates both of those great truths. We look at the cross of Jesus and we see anguish and we see suffering and pain. And yet in spite of the horror of the cross and all that Jesus endured for us, there is the truth of life for those who would place their faith in Him, know Him as their Savior and Lamb, knowing forgiveness of sin. He fulfills that. So we share in our purpose. Now, again, children are central to the Passover observance. And one of the things kids would say at the table is, things look different. And you know, kids are always asking questions. Oh, observances can be always asking questions. And so what? And they would often, as part of the Passover Seder, recite or sing and chant a some questions. We're going to do it by reciting today. We have to finish the chant. The chorus of the chant is Hebrew. It's Ma'ish Kanal Halayla Hazeh Mikol Halayot. Translated, why is this night different from all of the nights? And the kids are making that statement, observing everything that is unique on the table. So we have some children asking questions tonight, and I already hear this. Let's see, Isaiah Porter is going to be first. Here's Isaiah, and this is, he's over here. And why on this night do we eat only matzah? Now that would be a logical question for me, because every Sabbath dinner on Friday evening when I would go to my grandmother's house, at the center of the table would be a fresh baked loaf of challah. That is my absolute favorite is bread. Go to Wegmans, they sell it. It's good. It's not exact, but it's good. Anybody work for Wegmans? It's good. I did say it was good, right? Delicious, like an egg bread. Spectacular. And always at the Sabbath meal, but not at Passover, 38 days, no challah, only unleavened bread. So a logical question, the kids are asking, where's the challah? All of your nights, there's challah, now nothing, only matzah. Important teaching time. On your table, you have a plate full of matzah. We'll be sharing it in several places tonight. And remember again, when God instructed the Israelites to leave, they had to leave quickly. They had to wear their traveling robes, have their traveling staff in hand, wear their walking traveling sandals in preparation to leave Egypt quickly. That was God inventing fast food. No, he wasn't McDonald's. Give up. God prepared them, but after that, reclining and relaxing, but there's the matzah, unleavened bread, baked in the heat of the sun. You notice the matzah. Interesting things as we'll partake of in a few minutes. Several things about the matzah. Traditional Middle Eastern matzah is probably round and square. It's a very good thing. Maybe it's easier to box. But several things about matzah are intriguing. One thing that you might notice that it's got kind of these lines or stripes. Piercing. And it's kind of interesting. I'm not sure there's any intentional connection, but we remember the words of the prophet Isaiah, who said he was pierced for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, the chastening for our peace fell upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. 700 years before the coming of Jesus, even that in the matzah. But much more than that, at every Passover table, this has been true now for thousands of years, there was a white linen napkin like this roll on the table. It's called a matzah tach. Have you tried that before? And inside the matzah tash, there are three pieces of matzah, individually kind of just placed. One up on the top, and one in the middle, and one on the bottom. Three pieces of matzah, separated, wrapped inside one white linen napkin. If you ask the rabbis what the matzah tash means, the likelihood is you'll get one of two responses. One, they'll suggest it refers to our patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Joseph. Others will say, no, it refers to our worship, the Levites, the priests, and the congregation. The fact is, they're not sure. So there isn't a one definitive answer. but it is a tradition, part of the liturgy of every Passover, and has been for thousands of years. The middle piece, only and always the middle piece. And remove from the montage. Middle piece will be broken. The Passover, this will happen in millions of hundreds of years. Half of the broken piece would then be wrapped in another white linen cloth and hid somewhere in the house. The kids had to know, had to close their eyes, not peek, not look. Trust me, nobody did. Hid in the house. And then afterwards, they come back. Sounds strange, doesn't it? A strange game that goes on. Keep that in mind. We're going to talk about it after we eat to understand its real significance and meaning. Middle piece of matzah removed, broken, half of it wrapped, and hid. The piece of matzah broken and hid is the only non-Hebrew word used in the Passover Seder. It's called the afikomer. Let's try that one. Afikomer, that is the Hebrew word. Well, we can talk about the definition of the word. By the way, I already took care of the wrapping of the piece and putting it somewhere, but we'll come back to that later. So, okay, there's question number one, and more to come with that. Second, text statement moment. We first have another question to ask, but I think, let's see. Cameron Weisel is going to ask a second. Can you speak real loud, Cameron? You have a mic. Can we have the turkey and the Okay, Cameron, here's your moment. Thank you, Cameron. Give Cameron and Isaiah a hand. How old are you, Cameron? How old are you?
Seven.
Seven, yeah. Some bitter herbs. Kids are recognizing, not the typical vegetable, but the bitter herbs tonight. So here's what you're going to do. You have matzah on the table. You're going to take the matzah and you're going to break off a nice bite-sized piece of matzah. Nice full bite-sized piece. And then you have this, the bitter herbs and the horseradish. That will be juice red. And what you're going to do is take a little bit of a nice bit of the horseradish and put it in a broken piece of matzah, a bite-sized piece of matzah. Go ahead and do that. Start it off, so take a nice bite-sized piece on it. Scoop some of the horseradish right on top. While you're doing that, I'll recite the Hebrew prayer and I'll translate it to see if we can do some things at once. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kidishanu b'dvaro b'dvar. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has commanded, separated us by his word, and commanded us to eat the bitter herbs. And so, you have a piece of matzah with a horseradish on it, and if you do, when you get it, then come to us, go ahead and eat it. If we were on the dinner table, we'd have homemade horseradish. Last year, we did that for the first time. It's fun. And when my grandmother made homemade horseradish, I want to tell you, when you put that horseradish on top of the matzah and ate it, your eyes filled with tears, and you began to eat. I always tell the story, way back at our church on Long Island, I think. No. Todd? Huh? We they did this in my previous church early on in the years there, and my oldest son Jeremy brought to school and brought his friend Todd to church, and he had never been to the Passover before, and I knew what he was going to do. We got to this, the horse rally was pretty fighting, pretty strong, and we were spreading it around. My son Jeremy made his friend Todd take a huge, almost a tablespoon, heaping tablespoon of horseradish on top of the cans of matzo. I'm watching out of the corner of my eye thinking, this is going to be good. And Todd's real fair skin, red hair, and when he ate that matzo with the horseradish, his eyes bulged out, took over half of his face. His skin turned reddish, like your sweat. And it was funny. It was nasty, but it was funny. Tears again. We want to remember, solemnly remember, the suffering and anguish of our people in love. We never want to forget God's instruction. We never forget. We never forget the suffering. Yet His grace and mercy delivering them from the Lord. So the question about the individuals. Now there's a third question, and Gabe Younger is going to ask the third question. Over here. Observation based upon what we're going to do. We're going to be dipping a second time. So what you want to do is grab another nice bite-sized pizza hot sauce. And you'll notice this, it's actually an apple mix, beautifully done. Apple, and usually there's honey, and sometimes lemon juice, and sometimes grape juice and wine. And what you want to do is get a nice piece of matzo and a nice healthy portion of this apple mix on the matzo. Let me do that. We'll explain a little bit. You remember during the course of Moses going back and forth with Pharaoh, demanding that the people of Israel be free, Pharaoh's heart continually was hardened. And as he saw the people of Israel continue to grow and prosper, even through hardship of slavery, what he decided to do was double down on the bondage and responsibilities. Not only would they be responsible for building Pharaoh's fortresses, pyramids, in addition to that, what he said was, now you're going to make your own bricks, and you're going to make your own mortar. Figure out how to do it. You're not just going to stack it and build it, you're going to make your own stuff. And it became that much more difficult for Jesus. And the haroset, there's another great Hebrew word, haroset. Want to say that one? Haroset. It is designed to communicate the mortar that was used to build the bricks for Pharaoh. Not in this world. And yet out of that mortar, out of that anguish, there is the sweetness of liberation and life and pain. And so this one has a very sweet flavor to it, much different than the bitterness of the bitter herbs, the horseradish. So you have that part of you. Later on, you can finish this stuff from the bed plate. That always gets to be a favorite for the next edition of the book. It's a good one. So you get that imagery? The picture? Sweetness of freedom. Out of that language of suffering. Okay, we have question number four. Now, Gabe's up on the brother Tate. Can you read that?
Moses
This one's difficult because we're sitting in chairs, but typically the Passover we would be reclining on the floor of the table settings, maybe on some pillows, maybe on one side. After that first Passover, quick, fast, I believe, from then on, God said, once I free you, once you come through, once I give you the land of covenant promise, you will now be in a place of peace and rest. I will fulfill that promise to you. You'll be able to relax. How many of you are familiar with the Da Vinci painting of the Last Supper? Let me just say it in one word. Not. A good deal, whatever, 1500s or so, translation, make-believe, kind of close. That's a nice recreation from that time period, but nothing from resemble what would have been the original Passover. Any of the ones you find, we would be reclining at ease to rest. Thankful to God for his deliverance and his faithfulness, remembering that in our position. It's to remind us again who Jesus is. He is the one who is our peace. The Apostle Paul said of Jesus in Ephesians 2:14, he himself is our peace. The Hebrew term describing Messiah by Isaiah the prophet, Isaiah 9:6, he is Sar Shalom, he is the Prince of Peace. The book of Hebrews chapter 4 says, for those who believe in Jesus, there remains a Sabbath rest, a place of spiritual rest, for finally the burden of our sin is removed, and he sets us free. He completes that picture. So there's the four questions. And before we eat, take a break. You have one cup. Remember what that was called? Sanctification, the Hebrew word, kadesh, setting you apart. The second cup is the cup of plague to the cup of judgment. The second, I will promise of God in Exodus 6:6, I will free you from being slaves. And that freedom will involve horrific judgment of God upon Israel. In the form of one plague following another, foul hardening his heart, hardening his heart, hardening his heart, until finally the last plague, the brokenness that was brief, death of the firstborn, allowing the Israelites to find their fighting freedom. Incidentally, for historical folks, if you like to find some historical corroboration, you can do that. And not only ancient discoveries of Egyptian cave drawings, but also on ancient pottery and in the Code of Hammurabi. There are actually references of the Hebrew people and their time not only of bondage, but of leaving. Only in the Egyptian story, they wouldn't reference the miracles, for they would never want to give credit to a miraculous God who is greater than their pagan gods or their pagan emperors. But all of that gets corroboration as far reality. The plagues that fell upon Egypt, the miracles, we will rehearse. And the way we're going to do it, there is a napkin on top of your, something is a small square napkin, which you'll want to have along with your cup. And what we are going to do, I am going to shout out one at a time in play. You will respond with some vote. I'll shout it out, you'll respond, and for each one that we shout out, you dip your pinky kind of into your cup of juice, dripping it onto that napkin. It is to symbolize the loss of life, death, judgment, suffering that befell the Egyptians, that the Israelites were spared from the plagues. We're going to do that, then I'll make a comment briefly after. You understand what we're doing? I'm going to shout now. You're going to respond to what we're doing. We'll get the heck of it pretty quickly. Ready? Water to blood. Frogs. Lice. Flies. Livestock. Boils. Hail. Locusts. Darkness. Death of the firstborn. It's a solemn cup. A cup of plagues and judgment. to remember that there was a price paid for the freedom of the Israelites. The miracle of most of those plagues, I like to share this at Passover as a point of observation and plunder. Virtually all of the natural phenomena of these plagues, water turning red, plagues of frogs, of mice, of flies, affecting livestock, boils, hail, all of these, locusts, all of these were natural phenomena at different seasons and times that were commonplace in portions of Egypt, every single one. I remember when I taught high school Bible, I had a picture in 1972, Cairo, Egypt. Picture I would show our kids. And what the picture showed would be millions of locusts in the air flying across Cairo, the capital of Egypt. Stunning portrait. As an illustration, all of these plagues weren't unheard of. The miracle of the plagues was threefold. One, the timing. They occurred exactly when Moses made the proclamation. Everyone. Two, it was the breadth of the plagues. It wasn't localized in one region, in one city, in one corner. It was sweeping across the entire nation of Egypt. That they had never known. And three, the miracle, the Israelites in the middle of Egypt, in the Nile River Valley, in the end of the Fertile Crescent, the Israelites were spared from every one of those cataclysmic judgments of God. The Egyptians completely tormented. The Israelites were looking around saying, wow. There's the real miracle. I submit to you that those three are greater miracles than anything else. To show God's sovereign, determined, providential will and accomplish his plan, the purpose, and proposal for freeing the Israelites from bondage. Now, just before we a lot of what we did not do tonight is on the traditional Hebrew chants and songs from over time. One of my favorites that we usually do that right before we eat is a song called Dayenu, which in Hebrew basically translates to "It would have been enough." And we would simply rehearse together in form what God did in delivering the Israelites from bondage. And one stanza might say, God, if all you did was bring us out of Egypt and did nothing else but bring us out of Egypt, I couldn't have asked for any more. It would be enough. It would be presumptuous of me, arrogant of me, pompous of me, to require or expect you to do more than that. That's what it's done. But you didn't stop there. In addition to bringing us out of Egypt, you also brought us through the Red Sea safely. If that's all you did, got us out of Egypt, got us through the Red Sea safely, if that's all you did, I'm fine. Don't need anything else. Don't ask for anything else. Dayenu, it would have been enough. But you didn't stop there. In addition to that, he took us out of bondage, he took us through the Red Sea, and for 40 years you fed us in the wilderness. Amazing. In this desert wilderness, you fed us every single day. Miracle! If that's all you did, it would have been enough. I couldn't ask for anything else. Now you know. Took us out of Egypt, took us through the Red Sea, you fed us in the wilderness. What more could I want? You gave us the Torah. You gave us the law. You gave us your word. You gave us your promises. You gave us the covenant. God keeps giving and giving. And the response is, I ain't it, please. I deserve it. It's called grace. God giving us what we can't earn. It reminds me of the fifth chapter in the book of Romans, which is the New Testament version of Dayenu. Studied on your own without time tonight. But Paul then begins to list some of the treasures that we have simply because we belong to Jesus by faith. And he begins by saying this, therefore, having been justified by faith, Have you placed your faith in Jesus who died for you, rose for you, believing he was your substitute, paid the price for your sin, knowing that he has declared you to be righteous, that his very holiness permeates you, dwells within you? If that's all that he did, ain't it to be enough? But Romans 5 then begins to list so many of the other treasures that God does for those who live. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God. We have access to God. We have the joy of knowing we will one day exalt in the hope of the glory of God. We have the ability to even rejoice in the hard times. We have the ability to know we have the love of God that is shed abroad in our hearts and he develops it by angles. Reasons to be eligible. We'd sing that song like that. On the Seder plate, there is a brown egg. It's actually a brown egg that's been hard boiled. It's there. By the way, if you want to eat it later, with the horseradishes. Just a hint. Oh, by the way, make sure you shout out first. So, but a brown egg would typically be a roasted egg. And the roasted egg is a reminder of the sacrificial lamb at the Passover, God instructing the Israelites to take a lamb, first year male, roasted, burning by fire, and the egg is a reminder of that sacrificial lamb and a reminder of life that comes out of death. Principle of substitution at the Passover, which we'll reference in a second. So that's what the egg is there for. And the last article that's there is a shank bone. I have a mind on your plate. So I have one here. And the reason for the shank bone is because there's no more temple, no more place for sacrifice, and generally speaking, Jews do not eat lamb at Passover any longer. Few areas of the world they did, but very, very good. No longer lamb substitutes like bullock, chicken, and beef. But no longer lamb. The shank bone is there to remind us of the sacrificial lamb. Remember that last plague. God's instruction for the Israelites is clear. Take a lamb, one for each family. You're to kill it. And while you'll be roasting the meat to eat it, you're to take the blood of that lamb. And what you do is to place it on the side post of the house and on the top post of the house. Right? Blood will go in on the side posts and the top posts. And God's promise, if you do that, God's judgment of death that will move across Egypt, the angel of death, the judgment of death, will pass over. God's judgment will pass by or pass over your home. You will be spared because of the blood of the lamb as a substitute for you that protects you from the judgment of God. Place the blood on the signposts and the top posts. On the signposts and on the top posts. Signposts. One of the many hidden unknown metaphors in that first Passover is one that would be perhaps easier to see several thousand years later. Even their portrait of the one who would be the final Passover, the Lamb of God that John serves, who came to take away the sin of the world. It was our substitute to our place. The suffering on our behalf, the sinless one, perfect one, holy one, you and I might make the moment. So that completes the most of our observance. We can pray in a moment, and then the food will come. We'll have a good dinner together. A fairly traditional Passover dinner that we'll enjoy. Lunch will go soon. That's very traditional. chicken with some typical vegetables you have to have, and sometimes you enjoy a meal as well. We'll have a meal together, and then after we come back for our last 20 minutes, very powerful conclusion that I know you shared. So hope that this has been helpful and instructive for you. Would you pray with me, and then we will enjoy our meeting hungry? Let's pray together. Oh God, we're grateful. We're grateful that you are the great provider, the one whose covenant promises yet follow us if we would believe in the one who is the Lamb of God, the Passover Lamb, who took our punishment on the cross for our sin. We're grateful that we can celebrate this observance and see its completion in Yeshua Jesus, who gave himself for us. Lord, we ask you to encourage us and the fellowship we share at the tables, the food that we enjoy, the many hands that have prepared them, that we might celebrate with great joy and great wonder, reflecting on your grace and your mercies. So receive all our thanks for all that is coming our way as we worship you together. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay,
like a filter fish would be common in, you know, filter fishes. Brown,
sharp and lighter than some others, and you grab it together into kind of an oblong ball. You bake it, and then you chill it, and you serve it maybe on a little lettuce and horseradish. My grandma's looking. You can buy the stuff at the stores now. It's not even hardly a reasonable effect, so. So we might have something like that for that type of anything. Of course, common you would have potatoes, less common. The potatoes might be in the brisket paint, but if you have chicken, you might have like a matzah stuffing. That would be a potato. That is very, very special, delicious side dish. Along with carrots, that would be common, a rooted vegetable. So that would be, you could have maybe for dessert, sponge cake with fruit all over it, again made without leaven. Lemon bars, different types of cakes. The chocolate matzah is an American consequence of spoiled kids. So that kind of came along through the years. Everybody likes the chocolate matzah. We're still working on it. So yeah, the chocolate matzah has some weight. So I hope you enjoyed the food. And the last concluding part of the Passover Seder, it's very special. We've already had how many cups?
That's it.
We had two, which means how many more left? And we answered four questions and so forth, but one we left unanswered, right? The first question about, on all other nights we might have cholera, why on this night matzah only? Remember we took the matzah tash? And we broke each piece. Middle piece and we broke it, and we said that the product would be wrapped again and hidden. So all of that's common tradition. We talked about its symbols. And so the conclusion of the Passover revolves around the matzah and the third cup, particularly, that we give particular attention to. So what happens next? After we gather together, the kids always wonder about the afikomen, which is hidden somewhere. And we've actually done this. So what we're going to try to do, if we can, well, let's see how many children this long night. How many children do we have, let's say, from kindergarten age through like fourth grade? Let's start there. How many children would be like kindergarten age to fourth grade? Raise your hands up top. Kindergarten age, and you have left back how many times? Kindergarten through fourth grade. Raise your hand. Realize I can go and see how many are here. Got a bunch at that table and back there. How about any fifth graders over there to add to that? Okay, so we'll do this. This is good. Kindergarten through fifth grade. Okay, that's what we're going to do. And what we do, what would happen in the home would be after we kind of gather back together again, and all of the young children would be released to search for the hidden piece of matzah, the afikomen, that they have done. Go search the house. I can remember as a young kid running through the house with my brother, who was 3 years older. Not fair. It's not fair. It was tripping. My cousins were a lot younger. I tripped them. But we'd run through the house. My grandmother would be yelling, "No, wait!" Furniture, living room, cushions, everything flying all over the place. Gotta find the opportunity. It's a game that's fun. And then the teacher was battled. We'll come back to my grandfather to retrieve the blessing. So what we're going to do is simply say that somewhere in this room, I am hidden, wrapped in a white napkin, the afikomen. It is somewhere around. I won't tell you where, but I'm going to count to three, and then you kindergartners through fifth grade, we will unleash you to find it. And I will tell you this, if within about 5 or 10 seconds or so, no one's close, I might play the game, you're cold, your ice cold, and if somebody's trying to get out, I'll get getting warmer, just so that we're not here for a long time, because it is a big deal. I mean, my grandmother's living room, there weren't all choices. So you're ready to go. Those of you who are going to do this, I want you to stand up. Kindergarten to fifth grade, stand up where you are. Look, it's cool, y'all. Stand up. Come on, wise guy, you know fifth grader. Okay, so we got a bunch over here and over here and over here. Okay, pretty good so far. So, I'm going to count to three, okay? And then, when I say three, see if you can find it. You ready? How many of you are ready to go, you guys? You ready to go? Okay. One. Two. Two and a half. Three. Go. See if you can find it. It's in somewhere around. Whoops. Back down to two. So far, nobody's here. Somebody's getting a little warmer over here. I saw some of the things that surprised me, but this one, completely left to be prepared. It was typical of a complete Seder without tears. Afikoma. Greek, the one who has come. Oh, he has come. For I have come. The Mazatash. One white linen wrapper. One symbol of holiness, purity. God is one God. The most repeated Hebrew phrase at Sabbath worship, over and over and over again chanted, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Hebrew word echad that is used is not the Hebrew word that would signify one as in absolute singular. The Hebrew word echad is one as in unity. For example, if I were to say on Passover, our family gathered as one for Passover, we would use echad, one family made up of many people. If I was to speak of our congregation, Berean Church, I would say we are one church, an echad church made up of many people, but one. If we speak of the nation of Israel, we would speak of Israel as being one nation, but echad, made up of millions of people. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. The Lord is one. As you do. The Matzah Tosh. One God. One God. One God. One God. Not three. One. Three pieces of matzah in separate work sections. God the Father. God the Son. God the Holy Spirit. One God. One God. One God. Three portions of the matzah. And the middle piece, only and always the middle piece, is removed from the matzah touch. The middle piece that was taken and broken. And the afikoman, I have come, is wrapped and hidden. Chapter 22, verse 19. When Jesus had taken the bread, when Jesus had taken the matzah and given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to them. And he said, this matzah, the afikoma, represents my life-giving. He is the one who has come. He is the afikoma. He is the one without leaven, without blemish, without spot. He is the perfect Holy One of Israel. He is the pure, spotless Lamb of God. From Hebrews and the 7th chapter, holy, undefiled, and without sin. He is the one who has come, who was broken for us, who gave his life for us, who was buried in. Later in the meal, 3-day symbolism. The Baki Komen has his retreat. The resurrection of Jesus. He's risen from the dead. And brought back to the patriarch, there is a reward that is given. And for those who would know that Yeshua is the perfect lamb Passover. The one who has come to be broken for us, to give his life for us as a priest, not just to provide a lamb, but as the priest to become the lamb. To fulfill that which Johann John said. Behold, the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sin of the world. He is the one who was broken for us, who died for us, who was buried for us, who was raised from the dead, and the reward for those who believe. No guilt. Even for me. But the free gift of God is eternal life from Jesus Christ. Sat through that Passover in the spring of 1972, and I was left breathless. Because my entire life, we had enacted and reenacted every single year, and in millions of Hebrew homes for thousands of years, and it will unfold again in 2 weeks. Millions of homes all across the world. Hundreds of thousands in the New York metropolitan area alone where I come from. They will reenact at the Afikoman the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, the Lamb of God, and have absolutely no clue what it means. Jesus took the bread and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, he did so having prayed this prayer. When you've taken the matzah and given thanks, this is the prayer we pray. Baruch atah Adonai Elohim melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. Bread was always a symbol of physical sustenance. God fed the people of Israel in the wilderness. He was Jehovah Jireh, their provider. But bread became a greater symbol of greater truth. Remember after the feeding of the 5,000, the miracle of multiplying loaves and fish, Jesus used it as a platform for a teaching tool. What did he say of himself? What great I am statement is announced in John chapter 6. I am the bread. I am the source not only of your physical life and physical sustenance. I am the source of your spiritual life and spiritual sustenance. If you don't partake of me, if you don't know me, if you don't draw near to me, if you don't come to me by faith as the one who is the Lamb paying for your sin, you have no life. No spiritual life. So when he broke the bread and gave it to his apostles, disciples, and encouraged them to partake of the bread, he was encouraging them to recognize that they would trust him, follow him, and believe. They would have come to know the one who is the bread. He is the unloving one. For that's why. So why don't we grab a little piece of matzah? Go ahead and break a piece, make sure it's got the home. Break this small piece off by side. I understand that some of you come from different churches, different traditions, different thinking, different lots of stuff. It's one of the areas I tend to go a little conservative, a little conservative. Because I've struggled for 40 plus years with the fact that much of my brothers and sisters in Jesus have tragically stripped the real meaning of the traditions that have been self-identified, Eucharist, Holy Communion, Lord's Supper, whatever terminology is used, it is largely done completely stripped of its meaning. Totally. And probably, just point in the recovery. But you see, in the context of Passover Seder, it really explodes, doesn't it? It's all there. There's not something magical or mystical happening. The Passover is filled with symbolism. We did symbols all the way through, didn't we? We all did with symbolism. There's nothing unique in the matzah. It's symbolic like the karpas. It's symbolic like the horseradish. It's symbolic like the haroset. It's symbolic like the salt water. Everything symbols a great truth. So is the matzah. The symbolism is here. It isn't mystical or magical, but all of a sudden you're very Eastern book philosophical in our theology. And hello. It's a greater symbol. Our Savior, the speaker is born, and the Savior. And so partaking of the bread is just a statement of saying, Jesus, I thank you that you are the source of my spiritual life. You are the source of my eternal life. Eating the bread is a way of saying, I have placed my faith in you, my trust in you, I identify with you, I follow you, you gave your life for me. So if you know him as your Savior, Lord, I invite you to join me in partaking of the matzah, because he is the perfect one. Chapter 22, verse 20. And Jesus, the Messiah, lifted up the cup and said, in the same way, he took the cup after they had. How many cups are there in the Passover? How many before you eat? How many after you eat? Cup right after you eat. The cup of redemption. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm. I will buy you out of bondage. After they had eaten, now I know which cup Luke's talking about. Jesus took that cup after they had eaten and said, this cup now represents a new covenant, sealed with the shedding of my blood, which is poured out for you. Just as the matzah speaks, greater meaning, so the cup does. It's not a cup representing a physical deliverance from physical bondage. It's no longer just an issue of we're taking you from this land where you're slaves and now putting you in this land where you're free, the covenant land, much greater redemption. A redemption and deliverance from sin that condemns us, that consumes us, that allows us to be presented guilty before God. Lost in debt in our sin. Jesus becoming that lamb buys us out of the slave market of our sinfulness that leaves us condemned before God under control of sin, sets us free so that we can be raised and walk in newness of life. That is the new covenant. It is a redemption from spiritual death to spiritual life. From just physical life. Jesus took that cup, the cup of redemption, speaking of a new covenant, sealed in the shedding of his blood. We drink of that cup, remembering his atoning work for us, and the greater redemption we can offer. This reminds us of the simple truth. You and I, we owe a debt we can't pay. And Jesus, he paid a debt he didn't know. That's the good news of the gospel that Passover You'll be that. Everything that you've done for us. As we conclude tonight, we make note of the fact that at the end of every Passover table is an empty place setting. We refer to it earlier. It is a place setting for Elijah. For the Old Covenant speaks of Elijah, or one like Elijah, in the person of Elijah, who announced the coming of Mashiach, the Messiah. And we know from the New Covenant that Johann John fulfilled that role. He is the one who announced the coming of Messiah, makes straight the way of the Lord. It is believed by many rabbis the Messiah will come in Passover. And so a place setting is there for Elijah with a cup of wine and all that would be there. And at the end of every Passover Seder, one of the youngest children would go to the nearest door where that chair would usually be, closer to the door. And we would open the door briefly. Maybe Ben, since you're closest, would you mind just kind of going out here in the door and say, wait for a second, just hold it up and you can leave the spot and see the light right. So, come here. And we would open the door wide and we would bid Elijah welcome to our Passover. For if Elijah comes in Pesach, we would know the Messiah would be soon to come. And we long for the coming of Messiah. Thank you. Appreciate it. Our invitation would be that my grandfather would have to play a trick. When we wouldn't look, we'd have the goblets of wine, and when the kids weren't looking, we would keep drinking. That's wondered by my grandfather. His face got red at the end of the Passover. Happy that I played up here. Oh, no, no. And the kids say, wow, look, Elijah must have come. The desire for Messiah to come. And that's the great wish of Passover. That the next Passover would be one where the Messiah would come and would share the kingdom. The last cup, the cup of praise, we will be able to live together. It is the cup of covenant, the promises we sing from Psalm 136 and some of the Hallel Psalms. A song of celebration, reminded of God's faithfulness to us. But we will remember that God is the God of covenant promises that we can rely upon and count upon. And we will begin where we would end, holding the cup of Ruchatadabai, Elohim Melech HaOlam, Borei HaGafen, blessed are God, the Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the food of life, who creates life, spiritual life, and nothing. And so we honor him and we carry the book. While the wine has been left out, we certainly covered a lot with you of an overview of the meaning of Passover with its greatest fulfillment in history. I probably should tell you the end of the story of Passover in 1972. While I sat there holding my breath, but weeping for you. At the end, we had moved from the table, gathered in the family room. The furniture was stood back upright, and she was back in place. And we gathered and relaxed. I knew it was going to be a tense night. The family knew that I had come to believe in Jesus. We had already locked tensions for 6 months. I was surprised the friend had ready. We had come. At that point, I was engaged to my wife, Linda. She was with me. Mom and Dad were there. Our family was here. And at the end, casual conversation. Then it got pointed out to get that way. My aunt and uncle was home week for me. So how could you do this to us? Here you've even celebrated the Passover with us. How could you do this to us? How could you believe in Jesus? How could you betray us? How could you betray your people? How could you betray your religion? How could you betray your... And it's like a chinga. Boom, 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 boom. And get hot. But I kept hearing the how-to question. So when I got a little quiet, I thought, you've opened the door, Lord, with about 5 or 6 how-to questions. I guess I could say something. So I started to share just what I experienced in that past night, how how incredibly meaningful it was to me. And I shared with them a little bit about the opportunity. I didn't get too far before there was an explosion of anger and rage. They kicked us out of the house. I'll come back to you when you see it again. And then I left and reminded them about the loss. I really felt the schism of the family that happened for the last 19 years. One of the extraordinary things to rebuild relationships, but that was an easy question. But a seed was sown, a witness was born. The cross of love this year, Passovers will be celebrated. Maybe you know some Jewish friends who celebrate Passover, maybe before or after. You might want to ask them about their Passover, how it went. Maybe you'll want to say to them, hey, you know, I went to a Passover Seder. Sure, they get a teaching time. If you're ready to stand up for Yeshua and know that we have to count a cost, maybe God will give you an open door to share what Jesus knows you. And how this Passover speaks. And what the Alpha Kongo means. Will you leave them speechless? They won't. But Jesus said, he who speaks of me before men, I will be. Never be discouraged. It's not about us. Rejection's not about us. Screaming's not about us. It's only about him. And there is many more experience here than it was. For he included us. By his strengths. This has been a helpful time for you, one in which you've learned some things about the Passover. If you have any questions, I would be up here. I'll be glad to answer any questions you might have. I fill in some gaps to make myself available to you. And I appreciate that there are response cards that are on the tables. If you would please maybe take some time to fill that out and put that in the basket for my input. That's helpful. I'm going to close in prayer before we wish you folks. And I'm just so glad you were with us tonight. Remember to pray for the Holman family. My heart's heavy for them not with us. Would you join me in prayer? Yeshua Jesus, thank you that you are the Lamb. You are the once for all sacrifice. Thank you that every high priest stands daily ministering, offering the same sacrifices, which can never take away sin, only be a cover. But Jesus, after he offered himself once for all time, sits down at the right hand of the Father because it is finished. Thank you, the price is paid. Thank you that sins were purged and removed as far as the east is from the west. Thank you that we can know by faith in him, cleansing and forgiveness of sin, by faith have the reward and gift of eternal life, spiritual life, his indwelling presence in us. Thank you that we have relived not only the history of our people Israel, but the history of the ministry, the sacrifice, the death, burial, and resurrection of our Redeemer Jesus. May we see him in all of his glory. May we worship him in spirit and in truth. May we bow before him alone, who is the provision of forgiveness of sin. And we rejoice in that truth as we worship him in the name of Yeshua. God bless you. Thank you so much.